Christ is the world. Welcome to St. Matthew's Episcopal Church for our celebration of the second Sunday after the Epiphany. And we extend that welcome to those who are worshiping with us online at this time. Our worship service begins on page 355 in the red prayer book found in your pew. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God's kingdom.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our song of praise this morning is hymn 421.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, is the light of the world, grant that your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, may shine with the radiance of Christ's glory, that he may be known, worshipped, and obeyed to the ends of the earth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings from Holy Scripture.
A reading from Isaiah. Listen to me, O coastlands. Pay attention, you peoples from far away. The Lord called me before I was born. While I was in my mother's womb, he named me. He made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me a polished arrow. In his quiver, he hid me away. And he said to me, "You are my servant, Israel, in whom I will be glorified." But I said, "I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing and vanity. Yet surely my cause is with the Lord, and my reward with my God." And now the Lord says, who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him, and that Israel might be gathered to him, for I am honored in the sight of the Lord. And my God has become my strength. He says, "It is too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the survivors of Israel. I will give you as a light to the nations, that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth." Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel and his Holy One, to one deeply despised, abhorred by the nations, the slave of rulers, "Kings shall see and stand up, princes, and they shall prostrate themselves because of the Lord, who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm we will read responsively after the asterisk. It's in your bulletin. I waited patiently upon the Lord.
He stooped to me and heard my cry.
He lifted me out of the desolate pit, out of the mire and day.
Close. He set my feet upon a high cliff and made my footing sure.
He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God.
Many shall see and stand in awe and put their trust in the Lord.
Happy are they who trust in the Lord. Great things are they that you have done, O Lord my God. How great your wonders and your plans for us.
There is none who can be compared with you.
Oh, that I could make them known and tell them.
But they are more than I can count.
In sacrifice and offering, you take no pleasure.
You have given me ears to hear you.
Burnt offering and sin offering, you have not required. In the roll of the book it is written concerning me,
"I love to do your will, O my God. Your law is deep in my heart."
I proclaimed righteousness in the great congregation.
Behold, I did not restrain my lips, and that of the Lord you know.
Your righteousness have I not hidden in my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your deliverance.
I have not concealed your love and faithfulness from the great congregation.
You are the Lord. Do not withhold your compassion from me.
Let your love and your faithfulness keep me safe forever.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, together with those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you, because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift, as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. John saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me, because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, But the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, "He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The next day, John was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and who followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. Please be seated. Over these next several Sundays, we have readings that come to us in the scriptures from 1 Corinthians. This morning, we actually get the chapter 1, verse 1, right? A Paul called to be an apostle with Sosthenes. Bill said it better than I did. With Sosthenes, and to the people of Corinth, called to be saints, called together into fellowship with Jesus Christ. We have this reading, and really for the next several weeks, we have readings from chapters 1, 2, and 3, one right after another. And here we begin with this sense of calling, right? Paul called to be an apostle to the church, the Christians who are in Corinth, who are called to be saints. He uses the word call in that couple of verses that we just read. Some version of that word is there about 6 times in that segment before he moves on to the next and to the next. And the thing that starts to help us see the beginning and where he's headed in this whole letter that's, you know, a good 16 chapters long, it's good for us to understand and get an overview of the whole thing, of what Paul is trying to say, why he's writing a letter to the Corinthians in the first place. What is he trying to address? Why is he writing it? And who are the people he's even trying to talk to? Because it helps us to understand and to cast some light, shed some light on what's happening here, and find out if there's a word for them, if there's also something, a word that we can have from Paul, a word from the scriptures as well. Because the city of Corinth in the time that Paul is there, maybe around the year 50 or so, in that ballpark, he comes to the city of Corinth and begins to establish a church and moves on his next journey, and he gets a note back, as next Sunday we'll have the reading. It says, "I got a letter from Chloe in your church." And he actually gives us her name, this is nice. And he says, "I'm writing to you because she wrote me this letter." And some of the things that we know about what's happening in Corinth at the time are relevant for what's happening in Paul's church, in this community of Christians that has been started here. First of all, we know that it was a Greek city in modern Turkey, Asia Minor. It was a Greek city that had been taken over by the Romans, like they do. This is what they're good at. So they have Greek people living here, and now Roman people, who are Italians, are living here as well. They're moving from Rome and other parts of the empire, hoping to start new business and trade and make some money in the new market that just opened up. Also living in Corinth is a large community of Jewish people, mostly because the Roman emperor expelled all of the Jews out of the city of Rome about 10 years before. So the Jews who have come to Corinth are refugees. They're looking for their safety. They're looking for a new home. at this time. So we have Greeks and Romans, Italians, Jews. We have people from around Asia. So we have Asians, Jews, Greeks, Romans, all living in the same city, all of them with their own synagogues and temples, a very diverse and cosmopolitan city, all these people living together. We also know that there, of course, were people who were looking to be businessmen in the new environment, so they were making lots of money in the new markets that were opening up for Rome. And of course, there were tradesmen and manual laborers and other farmers and that sort of thing in the city as well. So we have a gap between the wealthy and the poor that is happening. So it is ethnically, racially, nationally diverse. It is has different kinds of wealth and income levels in it. We even know from just, like I said, Paul gets a letter from Chloe. That's a girl's name. Remember that. And whenever somebody says something about the position of women in the church, that first of all, Chloe was the one, she was clearly a person of leadership in the Corinthian church. She could see the problems. She wrote the letter to Paul, and Paul listened to her and believed her and acted on the things that she was describing in the letter. So we shouldn't forget the name of Chloe. When you hear that next week, you'll remember her position and her status as a leader in the church. So what does this start to point out for us? We don't really know what Chloe said. I kind of wish we had Chloe's letter to Paul. We only have Paul's letter back to her church. But from what he's starting to describe is the quite common problem that we know that it can be hard to have a community of diverse people, right? The diversity, it takes some work. And there, in that community, there were divisions between the rich and the poor. There are divisions between perhaps the people who came to join the church who used to be Jewish, those who came from other ethnicities and backgrounds and religions of the world, and there were problems happening. As we later on in the letter, we were finding out that the wealthier people of the church and the poorer people of the church were not sitting at the same tables and quite sitting at the same, sharing the same meals together, sharing the same communion the same way together. So it became a problem to try to address. And so how does Paul start to address that problem? He's been handed this, and he wants to know what can he say, what can he do to encourage them? And he begins this letter giving us the clue. One thing that he tells us is, again, Paul, called to be an apostle to the Corinthians, who are called to be saints, because you all call together, here it is again, you call on Jesus in your worship and in your prayer, and you have at the end of that we are called, what was the end? God is faithful. By him, you are called into a fellowship in his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. So this word of calling that comes up over and over and over has, I think, two different dimensions that are here. First of all, that God has given a call to Paul and to the Corinthians and everybody, that God makes a call on every person. Now, how we hear that call and how we receive that call can sometimes be difficult. I remember when I first went to seminary, about my first week of seminary, I met someone and she told me, oh, I knew God called me to go to seminary because I was going shopping and I was walking through the parking lot and I heard a voice tell me to go to seminary. And I thought, well, I wish it was that easy for me. I actually felt a little bad, like, wait, if she got that, I didn't get that. If she got that, and I didn't get that kind of a call, should I be here? Am I doing this? Am I doing it wrong? Am I doing God wrong somehow that I didn't get that? But of course, what is true is that God has a call on all of us. For some people, it becomes very obvious, very clear. Sometimes there are moments for us that it's very clear that God is giving us a call and asking something of us. And then there's those other times and for other people for whom it's hard to see, it's quiet, it's felt over a long period of time, it is felt and heard through other, not a voice from heaven, I don't know, the Walmart parking lot, but it comes through other people in little conversations and little moments here and there. Those little moments when you stop and you have that sort of gut feeling that, yeah, that I think that's the direction that God wants us to go. Oh, well, I don't know that, but somebody else encouraged me and said, you know, you should really think about this, or do you think God might be calling you to do something? Something's heard through other people. Sometimes we're ready to receive it, sometimes we are not. Sometimes we don't even notice that it is the call. I was actually going through my phone this week. Somebody called me, and I was trying to call them back. So, you know, I was going through my call log on the phone, trying to see who called me, and I looked at all those calls that I got on my phone. And there's some of them I didn't answer. Because I knew, I looked at the numbers and said, oh, that's someone who wants to tell me about my car's extended warranty. So I knew that's not a call to answer. That's probably not a call from God. That was not something that was going to be there. And of course, as we take that list and we look and see, what were those calls about? And how do they sound like the calls that sometimes come from God? Calls that sometimes I look at and say, I'm too busy to take that right now, God. I can't do that right now. I've got other things to do. There are sometimes I look at that call log and I go, oh, well, it can wait. Ooh, that's from someone I have to answer for myself in that call. I don't want that call. And then there's sometimes that you get that phone call and you think, oh, thank God. Thank God that person called me back. Oh, they need to tell me the thing that I need to hear. Or I don't know what's going to happen, and then they did tell me the encouragement, the word, the something that I needed, right, that the call, which comes from God, sometimes we don't recognize it. Sometimes we're a little too busy to take it. Sometimes we know we feel a little nervous when it comes. But sometimes it is a word of encouragement. As it's, Paul is saying in the letter, it's a word, a call that is about strength, that is about grace, about giving riches, not riches like some of the Corinthians were thinking, like they were going to be made wealthy in their new business markets, but a different kind of rich, a kind of richness that comes from spirituality, that comes from wisdom and knowledge, as he's saying, that the kinds of riches that are truly important were not about the kind that divided the rich and the poor, but brought everyone together in a richness that comes from Christ's grace alone. And of course, there is so much to be said about finding communities of diverse people being brought together in love and in grace. That is why we are still trying to understand the message of Martin Luther King, right? Some of us will get together tomorrow to go to the celebration. We're still working this out. I can't say it all in one sermon. I can't, even Paul couldn't do it in the first 9 verses, but he's trying to work this out. But he's reminding everyone that at the beginning, one place to start, could be recognizing that every one of us as Christians has a call from God. Every one of us is united, and that we come together to call upon God in worship and prayer and in song. And we have a calling that is all together because God is faithful, and by him you are called into the fellowship, into the communion of that one Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As we celebrate that one faith and that one calling, I invite you to stand as we continue in the words of the Nicene Creed on page 358. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He was suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in one Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. One holy Catholic and apostolic church, we acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Join me in the prayers of the people, Form 4, found on page 388 in the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray for the church and for the world, for Michael, our presiding bishop, Rob, our bishop, Jason, our rector, for this gathering and for all ministers and people. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. This week, we celebrate the birthdays of Peter Clark, Josh Desrochers, and Chris Calhoun. Lord, in your mercy, comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Jake, Roger, Jess, Karen, Skylin, Bob, Margie, Reinhardt, Sharon, Kate, Linda, Lisa, Judith Ann, Mary Lynn, Donnie, and Josh. And give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. We also pray for those who are homebound or hospitalized or in nursing homes, including Marilyn, Barbara, Lorette, Sally, and Sue. Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, remembering Ruth and Maynard Myers, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
life-giving spirit may so move every human heart that barriers which divide us may crumble, suspicions disappear, and hatreds cease. That our divisions being healed, we may live together in justice and peace through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Turning to the prayer on page 360, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Share with one another a sign of Christ's peace. We extend our peace to those who are worshiping online at this time. Peace. Peace, Johnny. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Great Thanksgiving on page 372 in the Book of Common Prayer, Eucharistic Prayer D, page 372. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right to glorify you, Father, and to give you thanks. For you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light inaccessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and fill them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day, and beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing. Reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care, so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might rule and serve all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help, so that in seeking you, we might find you. Again and again you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets you taught us to hope for salvation. Father, you loved the world so much that in the fullness of time you sent your only Son to be our Savior. Incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, he lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation. To prisoners, freedom. To the sorrowful, joy. To fulfill your purpose, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the grave, destroyed death and made the whole creation new. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose for us, he sent the Holy Spirit, his own first gift to those who believe, to complete his work in the world and bring to fulfillment the sanctification of all. When the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them, he took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Father, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption. recalling Christ's death and his descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting his coming in glory, and offering to you from the gifts you have given us, this bread and this cup. We praise you and we bless you. We praise you, we bless you, we give thanks to you, and we pray to you, Lord our God. Lord, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share in this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, Lord, your one holy Catholic and apostolic church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. And grant that we may find our inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, with patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them, and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body, for we all share in the one bread, the gifts of God for the people of God. As we prepare to receive communion here in the church, we join our prayers with those who are worshiping with us online, saying, Loving God, make me aware of your presence in this Eucharist and wherever I may be today. Abiding experience of your presence through Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Our closing prayer is on page 366 in the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of our Savior Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Please do take the bulletin home with you today. We have a number of announcements for things coming up in the life of St. Matthew's Church. I do want to give some quick gratitude today for our Kathy, our reader, and Blaine and Sean, who are our ushers today, serving, I believe, for the first time in both roles. So thank you all for accepting the call to those roles. After our worship service is concluded, we do have downstairs in the Undercroft refreshments for you. I'm told everything down there is gluten-free, so it is a gluten-free coffee hour. If you like gluten, sorry. We will all be gluten-free together as one today. So come down for that. And in two Sundays, not next Sunday, but the Sunday after, is January 29th. That is our annual parish meeting. After the 10 o'clock worship service, we will go downstairs. We'll share a potluck meal. We'll have reports about the past year, but also important votes to take. You have seen in your email and at the back of the church updates for our bylaws as a parish, as well as the election of vestry members and convention diocesan convention delegates. So those slates have been sent out over the past month. In two Sundays, we'll be doing that. At the back of the church, there is a sign-up sheet for the potluck. So it's helpful if other people are coming to not have the other people are coming, so if you're making something. But also to make sure that we don't all bring the same thing. Right? We don't want too many cookies, is the thing. So you can use that to write down that you are coming and what you're going to bring, and we can use that to make a good potluck for two Sundays from now. And now may the peace of God that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
peace to love and serve the Lord.